Welcome to Ring of Fire. I'm Mike Papantonio, and here's what's happening tonight. The dysfunctional Republican Party leaders believe that Paul Ryan, can save him from self-destruction, and will explain what their plan is and how it's destined to fail. Popular heartburn medications are causing very severe side effects in consumers, and we'll tell you everything you need to know about it. And BP is getting a huge tax break for destroying the Gulf of Mexico and killing people. We'll bring you the details in tonight's backstory. That's what's coming up tonight. You've just stepped in to the Ring of Fire.
There's been zero warming, none whatsoever.
I'm running for president of the United States.
Congress declares war, not the president. Start with the countries that are burning our flags.
We regret these errors and apologize.
We apologize.
We apologize.
And apologize.
This is good news, people.
Well, you know, Farron, news is an amazing story. Gulf settlement, the Gulf spill settlement that BP caused this horrible catastrophe, killed people, destroyed an ecosystem, destroyed the Gulf of Mexico. We're still facing the problems with it. But now we learn that they're going to get a tax break for all this. The U.S. government is going to give them a tax break for destroying our ecosystem, for killing people, for lying to the American public, for engaging in conduct that should have been RICO conduct. Tell me, how does this happen?
This is what happens when you have Democrats or Republicans in high office who put corporate political cronies into positions of power. This settlement, this is Loretta Lynch. This 75% write-off, $20 billion in civil and federal fines and penalties.
And she calls it the final hopeful chapter. Yeah. I mean, really?
$15 billion of the $20 billion, they get to write off 75% gone.
Taxpayers pay for their criminal conduct, and Loretta Lynch says, oh, gee, that's okay. I don't have any problem with that. I mean, isn't that what happens here?
That is exactly what's happened. She is out there touting this as some kind of great accomplishment for the government, for the people along the Gulf Coast. Has Loretta Lynch been down here to the Gulf Coast? Was she here? Was she paying attention to the news when that oil was flowing out of that well and washing up on our shores, you know, 200 yards from where we're sitting right now?
And I don't suppose I still don't suppose she understands what it's done to the ecosystem. She hasn't seen the dolphins, you know, washing up on shores with deformities. But the bigger story is this is a Democrat appointment by Obama, Loretta Lynch, who's supposed to be this law and order continuation of Eric Holder, who did nothing to white-collar criminals, and now she's trying to make this sound like, oh, this, her exact words, this is the final hopeful chapter in the way we've handled this. No, you haven't handled this, Mrs. Lynch. You haven't handled this. To have the taxpayers paying for this is absolutely out of the question. And, taxpayers are paying $15 billion because this woman simply wants this to go away and she wants to please corporate America. Well, it's just so disgusting.
Well, let me tell you what's even more disgusting. You know this all too well. I mean, because your law firm is one of the few that's been handling these cases. There are staff members and attorneys working around the clock, and they have been for 6 years trying to make things right for the victims of this oil spill. 7 days a week, these people are at it because they're trying to help people. And Loretta Lynch comes in, and now those same people who've been working around the clock to make things better, their taxes are going back to BP, the very company that did this.
Democrats don't matter. Obama doesn't care. He knew what he was getting when he appointed Eric Holder. He knew what he was appointing when he appointed Lynch. It's the same old ugly story, which brings me to the next story. 84% of Americans believe that money has too much influence in U.S. politics. That's what this story's about. I mean, that's exactly what this story's. We have criminals who are dressed up in suits, So we don't recognize that they're criminals because they have an Armani suit. They drive around Mercedes-Benz. They have a Rolex watch. They have MBAs. They went to Yale or Harvard. But they're criminals, okay? And when we dress a criminal up like that, we let them get away with whatever the hell they want to get away with, and the American public is starting to understand that. They're starting to understand money is in control of all of our politics, including Loretta Lynch, including Obama, including Hillary. By the way, the only politician that showed any outrage by this, about this BP story, guess who?
Bernie Sanders was right there on the front line. And you know what, though? The story about the money's influence in politics is huge, and it is so important right now, because the I'm with her crowd, the Hillary crowd, they don't understand that. They don't understand that, yeah, their candidate might be winning, but they are still on the wrong side of history and on the wrong side of the American public, both the Republicans and Democrats, because most of them want money's influence out of politics. And we're not going to get that if we put Hillary Clinton in office for 4 more years. And that is part of the appeal of Donald Trump, because he is not, you know, as corporately funded as the other Republicans, and so they do flock to that. That's Bernie Sanders' appeal.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, giant corporations, super rich, they've exerted way too much influence in politics. Even before Citizens United, it was overwhelming. But after Citizens United, they completely, not an overstatement, they completely control politics. Totally. They control the media. They control the judicial appointments. They control the White House. They control virtually all parts of our culture that has to do with us, you know, that has to do with hopefully getting better. There's no way for us to get better when we have too much money at the table making decisions for us, and that's what's happening. It's even worse since Citizens United, right?
It is. I mean, we're looking at $10 billion as the minimum amount that is going to be spent in total on the 2016 elections. Look, since 2012 and then 2014 and then 2016, we've had to do a story each one of those years about how this year's election is the most expensive ever. And I guarantee you, we're going to do it again in 2018 and then 2020, unless we solve the problem, which most Americans want us to do. Unfortunately, those people aren't in positions of power in Washington, D.C.
The Washington Wall Street Democrat, third way Democrat, Republican bubble is just too big to overcome, unfortunately. So where's the next Flint water crisis? That's a big part of the discussion out there right now about how bad our water is. This is a growing story. Flint has just gotten our attention. In about a minute, tell me where you think this goes next.
It goes everywhere where there's Republican leadership, because this is what happens. The Republicans come in, they slash budgets in order to get tax breaks for their corporate pals. Then they have no money to spend on infrastructure and fixing lead pipes. So they go unprotected. They have to cut EPA funding so the EPA can't regulate. And then when everything fails, when the EPA fails, when the government paid for lead pipes fail, the Republicans come back and say, see, we told you government isn't the answer, so let's privatize everything.
And the other part of that is they let corporations externalize all of their pollution, all of their costs, just like BP, where taxpayers end up paying for all their destruction, all their poison, all their suffering, all their health issues. Because DuPont's a great example. I'm going to trial again in that case in May. DuPont poisoned 70,000 people, their water sources for 70,000 people. And you know what? Not a one of them went to jail. And until you line up and do a perp walk with these corporate types, you're going to have Flint over and over and over again. Thanks for joining me.
Thank you.
The GOP is in bad shape right now. They have no leaders, no likable candidates, and no new ideas. But the establishment believes that they have a savior in Paul Ryan. And I have Howard Nations with me now to tell us why Paul Ryan won't be able to save that failed party. Howard Nations, another Paul Ryan. Will this guy ever go away? Will Paul Ryan ever just go away? You know, the last story that I thought was significant about Paul Ryan is the American public figured out that he's this huge Ayn Rand fan. You know, of course, yeah. Ayn Rand hates poor people. She hates the idea of government doing anything that benefits people. It is all the law of the jungle. So Paul Ryan was out there saying, you know, Ayn Rand's really brilliant. She's my hero. She has set my policy, my course, my political policy. And so now, interesting change. What's this little switcheroo we're seeing with Paul Ryan, where he's talking about he feels your pain. He's talking about poverty and how he feels their pain. What's your take on this?
Well, my take is my favorite American philosopher was Ralph Waldo Emerson, who said, "Do your own thing, and we shall know you." And Paul Ryan can say what he wants to say, but he's been doing his own thing ever since he's been in Congress. And he tells us that he is an acolyte of Ayn Rand, who wrote, of course, Atlas Shrugged. Atlas Shrugged is the Bible of the wealthy. Ryan says it's the most important book in his life. He requires all of his employees to read it. In today's world, the Atlas of Atlas Shrugged is Wall Street, it's the banks, it's the Chamber of Commerce, it's, as he says, the makers, not the takers. Progressives believe that a rising tide lifts all ships. Objectivism of Ayn Rand says you gotta run smoother if you throw your dead weight overboard. So in Ryan's speech to his interns, he seems to be softening his position on poverty and criminal justice. He's actually just trying to become the voice of reason counter to Trump's inflammatory rhetoric.
Okay, so
forgive me if I don't buy into it.
Howard, what's your call? Okay, he's going to show up at the convention. Trump is just a mud puddle right now. Cruz is becoming more of a mud puddle every day. We're finding out now that, you know, it's not that he just has these relationships with other women. There's a possibility that he's on the madam's list in two or three places. The guy obviously has some he has some orientation issues that that we're going to be hearing about. So the point is it may be that Paul Ryan is the only game in town, because Kasich, you know, there, for some reason, the Republicans have never embraced Kasich. You've got the Koch brothers putting millions and millions behind Paul Ryan. So read some tea leaves about that convention. What's going to happen with Paul Ryan?
Well, Paul Ryan is the fair-haired lad of the establishment. He's the protector of the status quo for the 1%. When he was chairman of Ways and Means Committee, he handled nothing but tax-cutting budgets. He was a protector of the tax breaks the corporate lobbyists fought so hard to get. As Speaker of the House, he's done the same thing. He's changing his rhetoric. He's not changing his policy. He's posing as the anti-Trump. The fact is, he's wholly owned by the wealthiest Americans. Now, he's going to be chairman of the convention. He is the establishment that will have to stop Trump. He'll stop him through the Credentials Committee, through the Rules Committee. You know, delegates are pledged to vote on the first ballot, but they're not pledged to follow current rules. So as convention chair, Ryan can get in there and change the rules and not seat delegates that Trump allegedly won.
But Howard, let me ask you, the rules can be changed on the fly. I mean, that's what people don't understand. I mean, Paul Ryan gets in there, he can change the rules on the fly. And if he does, he opens the door for the total destruction of Trump, the total minimalization of the importance of Ted Cruz. He can do all that, can't he?
Yes, he can. They also, in the Credentials Committee, we've already seen in Louisiana, where Trump won the state, that Cruz has gotten half the delegates. A lot of manipulation. That's through the Credentials Committee. So there are a lot of things that he, as the head of the convention, can do. But you know what's interesting, Pap, is who's missing from this? This is a presidential race. It's a Republican primary. Where is Karl Rove, the puppeteer-in-chief for the establishment?
Right.
Where is Sheldon Adelson? Where are the Koch brothers with their $700 million? Where are they in this race? So they're either one of two plans in place, probably. The extremely wealthy donors of the policy have either decided to concede the White House and put their money into the states or into Congress to protect the Senate, the House, the governorships, or they decided to replace Trump and Cruz at the Republican convention. I predicted some time ago that Trump was going to win the elections and be replaced at the convention by Romney. When Romney came forth forth to attack Trump. I said, okay, there's their guy. But now now the speculation is that it's going to be Ryan. I don't think Ryan wants it.
No, I don't think he wants it either. He's been through this one time already with Mitt Romney. It didn't have a good ending. It, matter of fact, there were so many attacks on what a nothing candidate he was, about his lack of understanding about really economic issues, which he comes to the table saying that I'm the economics guy. And when they started looking at his economics voodoo, it was nothing more than trickle down voodoo dressed up a little differently, but it was exactly the same trickle down voodoo that we know doesn't work. It was the biggest lie ever told by the Republicans. Ronald Reagan looked into a camera and just bold-faced lied to the American public about how trickle down economics had been proven and was going to work in the United States. It's the biggest economics lie that we've been told in a very long time. And Ryan was just an extension of that, wasn't he?
Well, Ryan has protected the tax breaks. He's given tax cuts, and he has actually, his policies decimate the safety net. So he's talking about being two-faced, talking about poverty now. He has always been the one that's just decimated the tax breaks. And, you know, the people who really are the puppets, most important puppets of the rich, are the House Ways and Means Chair, where he did that very well, and the Speaker of the House, because they control the budgets that protect all these tax breaks that they get. And yes, he's decimated safety nets. He's protected the rich all the way through. But I don't think it's in his best interest. The Republicans have a major problem. If they eliminate Trump, it's going to cause a revolt, which is probably going to lead Hillary to win. It's better for Ryan if he guides it to Romney. Romney has a good base. He's not going to win. But Ryan should be assured of the House speakership for 6 more years at least
now,
due to the successful gerrymandering.
Howard, now, you mentioned Hillary to win. Of course, you and I may disagree on this. Sanders is not out of this race. It's the media telling everybody that Sanders is out of this race. Every day, I'm seeing that edge up. It's just a matter of time. Does he have time? And if he takes Wisconsin... If he takes Wisconsin, it's a whole different ball game, Howard.
If he takes Wisconsin, it is a different ball game. But she's going to take New York. He's not going to touch her in New York, and she's got the biggest. She's going to get the biggest states in the union. Plus, she's got the superdelegate. So it's going to be very tough. But either way, if a Democrat wins the White House, which they certainly should, Ryan is far better off to stay as the House Speaker. He's going to have at least 6 more years to 2022. Because of the successful gerrymandering of the Republican Party in the House. We can't take it back because of gerrymandering until after the 2020 census. And so he gets 6 years there, and then, you know, he'll be the logical person to follow, the logical Republican to follow whoever the Democratic president is.
The truth is that the Republicans don't have a bench anymore. I mean, it's like the Democrats. Democrats don't have a bench either. And it's almost like there's just been too much nepotism. You know, there's just been the establishment politicians have just thinned out the real potential ranks so much that there's no possibility of real leadership. And so they've got that problem, and which is a great thing for Paul Ryan. I mean, if you're thinking about it here, Ryan has a chance now to say, look, I know I'm not that attractive, but I'm a heck of a lot more attractive than most of the candidates that the Republicans have to put forward. Don't you kind of see it playing itself out like that?
I see it very much playing itself out. Ryan is and shall remain the fair-haired lad of the establishment. Once they get all this Trump revolt, all the revolt of the right behind them, and it's going to cost them a lot to put that behind them. But once they put all that behind them, they come back to the establishment. If there is still an establishment there, then Ryan is going to obviously be the guy, because he's always been and always will be the protector of the 1%.
Howard Nations, thank you for joining us. Let's follow this Ryan story a little closer, okay? Appreciate it.
My pleasure, Pap. Thanks.
millions of Americans take a proton pump inhibitor every day in the form of Nexium and Prilosec. But what most of these people don't know is that these drugs come with some dangerous side effects. Joining me now to talk about these side effects is attorney Neil Overholtz. Neil, again, you know, it's just amazing to me. I remember an era when we were doing a pharmaceutical story maybe once every 6 months. Now there's a new pharmaceutical that we're hearing is killing people or it's crippling people in one form or another. This new case that you and your partners are working on right now is very scary. Nexium, I mean, that purple pill. Tell me about how has this developed into such a big medical issue?
So, Mike, you're right. I mean, the scariness and the what people described maybe over a decade ago as potential catastrophic consequences may have happened because the company that makes these proton pump inhibitors, AstraZeneca, didn't do anything about it. It's very scary. I mean, you're talking about a drug, Nexium, that is the most prescribed drug in the United States, most used drug. Last year alone, or in 2014 alone, it accounted for 15% of all prescriptions nationwide. And the scary consequence is kidney disease. Kidney disease is one of the most devastating diseases facing America's health system today.
Okay, let me stop you right here. Okay, you've got a proton pump inhibitor that's used for esophageal reflux, acid reflux symptoms. That first of all, if you look at the numbers and you look at what the literature that's coming out on it says, only 25% of the people who are using this actually need it.
That's right.
And it goes on and talks, Neil, about the idea that people are becoming addicted to the treatment. Once they start taking the drug, they can't stop taking the drug. Articles coming out that once they stop taking the drug, if they did not have esophageal reflux, after they stop taking it, they develop it. This is, and now add to it, the latest is it's closing down people's kidneys.
That's right.
This is another one of those stories. You go, what in the hell was the FDA doing? Where was the FDA in all this?
It's the mystery of all mysteries for a drug that is this widely prescribed, for a class of drugs that came into the market over 25 years ago, for this to have been brushed under the carpet for so many years is truly amazing. I've reviewed the FDA review papers when these drugs were approved and sent to market. There's not a discussion of the renal problem. You know, and Mike, where was the FDA? But you and I both know, and doing this as part of how we make a living, is that these companies have the responsibility to bring these issues to the FDA and to bring them to doctors. And they were being told by doctors as early as 1992 and continuing for the next decade, we think we see a problem here because this kidney disease that we're seeing in our patients, this is a kidney disease that is caused by drugs. It's not a different type of kidney disease. This is a specific type of kidney disease that is drug-related, and they knew about it.
Yeah, in other words, Neil, as you see, you know, this is something you specialize in just like I do. We see sometimes real patterns. In this pattern, they can actually see the kidney disease in the biopsy. They can tell this is a kidney disease that's directly related to proton pump inhibitors. So there's a term called pathognomonic. I don't think this is quite pathognomonic, which is to say there is one sign and one sign only. But this is a pretty strong sign of evidence when they can do pathology and then ask the patient, well, did you take Nexium? Did you take Prilosec? Let's talk about your history a little bit here.
No, you're right, Mike. The pathognomonic is something like in the fin-fin diet drugs where a pathologist at the Mayo Clinic looked at the pathology on these patients' heart valves and says, this is unique. This is unique to that diet drug, and we have a real problem, and blew the lid wide open on that litigation that a lot of people are familiar with. Here you had pathologists in the 90s and early 2000s saying, I'm seeing acute interstitial nephritis, a really serious damage to the kidneys that's drug-related. Now, you got to say, well, which drug was it? What drug were they taking? Well, so the studies that have looked at this most recently, and one of the studies that looked at a series of cases at major hospitals as far back as 2004, said, we can determine based on their medical records of these patients that are being reported, what drug did they start before this drug reaction happened? And they were convinced. They were convinced and wrote it in peer-reviewed medical literature that we are convinced it's these proton pump inhibitors like Prilosec and Nexium that are causing this problem.
And why, Neil, I think I know the answer to it because both you and I have always had to work these cases and we always see a dysfunctional, almost, I would go as far as saying almost a useless FDA. But the FDA knows about this information. They're getting it directly from the doctor. Look, I'm reading the same material. All I got to do is read this material that's coming out from doctors every week. It's saying this stuff has the ability to cause kidney disease. It can shut down the kidneys. They've been talking about for years that it causes hypomagnesemia, which is it's where it rids your system of magnesium, which you need, which in effect causes bone fractures, it causes heart disease, it causes blood test abnormalities, it causes liver toxicity. I mean, why is it that right now, as you describe in your review of this case, they've been looking at it for years, but still, all you got to do is go to the store and buy it, and there's no warnings on those packages at all.
So the FDA, as you know, Mike, can't require a company to do a study. And so when these doctors come forward with a review of a few cases in their hospital and say, look, we can look at the slides of the kidney tissue. We know that there's a drug problem here. You should do a study. That's what these doctors were telling the companies and the medical community back in the 90s and early 2000s is you should do a study. But the first time we ever saw a true epidemiological study to show an increased risk of either a immediate kidney injury or causing chronic kidney disease that leads to dialysis and even death was in 2014. And so it wasn't until 2014 that anything about kidney disease related to these drugs was even added to the labeling of these products.
What do you tell people? I mean, look, you say the same thing to people that I do, and that is, you know, go see your doctor about it, but don't take this stuff anymore. Most of the people who take it don't even have classic acid reflux. You know, and then they take the drug, and then they develop acid reflux after they stop taking it.
It's a really big problem, Mike. I mean, you can go to the store like I did last night and buy a box of Prilosec over the counter. You get the pills because you're having heartburn. And this is, we know so much more about what causes gastric reflux disease. And we know that it's mostly caused by bacteria today, and antibiotics may be the right therapy as opposed to another drug. But you buy this at the store, the only information you get is on the box. There's no write-up, there's no information, there's no doctor to tell you about what the risk may be. It's a really big problem. And people, if they're having gastric reflux problem, they need to go see their doctor and find out the real root cause of that problem and not just assume because of some fancy commercials, the purple pill and purple boxes at the store and the big displays that they can treat their gastric reflux, their heartburn, with a purple pill. They need to go talk to their doctor.
Neil Overholtz, I'm glad you're working on this case. You got great years of experience. You've got great history of great results. And I'm hoping you'll get to the bottom of this. We will certainly help you do that. Thanks for joining me, okay?
Thank you, Mike. Appreciate it.
That's all the time we have for today, but you can get more news at our website at theringoffire.com. You can get our daily podcast by going online to rofpodcast.com. And you can also subscribe to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/goleftTV. I'm Mike Papantonio, and we'll see you tomorrow.